I'm sure everybody in this room, it would be very surprising if everyone in this room doesn't realize that three blocks that-a-way is Harrington Street, where Jerry grew up. So that's one of the reasons why the Excelsior Library does this and why Jerry Day makes sense and why it's been, you know, just this righteous, low-key, fun, sweet event that this is sort of connected to and part of, and which is why I'm very pleased to be here. So thank you. And thank you to the public library system. I was teasing Daniela a minute ago by saying what I truly believe, which is that all librarians are saints, goddesses, or gods. I'm dead serious when I say if there's something better in our mixed up, miserable civilization, Western civilization, if there's something better than putting all the information that we have collectively into a place where it's freely accessible to everybody, if there's anything more civilized than that, I haven't found it yet. And I do think that the public library is like the best thing we've come up with yet as a civilization. So this, you know, it's a privilege to be here. I'm gonna mostly ramble and tell Jerry stories, which is, I figure, what frankly most folks wanna hear about. And most of them are kind of funny, I hope. you'll have to tell me. And then this is kind of cruel, but I decided rather than, as they say, shoot, you know, give away the best stuff at the beginning, I'm going to save for the end, as part of all the doodah of this year, of the 50th anniversary and the 20th anniversary of Jerry's passing. Jerry's estate asked me to edit together the transcripts of the interviews that I did with him in the 1980s, actually one in the 70s, that, you know, were part of my research. When I finished the research, or some years later, I took all those cassettes, as well as virtually all my other files, and most of my junk from Grateful Dead, you know, all those t-shirts and all, you know. We got a lot of t-shirts. When you worked on the road, you pretty much got a t-shirt a day. There's a limit to how many Grateful Dead t-shirts a man can wear. Or a woman. And I gave them to the archives at UC Santa Cruz. And eventually the estate came upon these cassettes and said, why don't you make a book out of it? And so I did. And it's called Jerry on Jerry. And it's, well, I think you'll like it. I think, it's Jerry talking about all manner of things, mostly because, unfortunately, there's hours missing. I don't know what happened to them. There are, you know, this is what we got, and that's some great stuff, including tangents, these great tangents that had nothing to do with Grateful Dead per se, that even then I was thinking, this is great stuff. But it doesn't, when you're trying to write a book that's already going to be 500 pages or whatever it was, you can't put it all in. And I didn't, and I cut it, and it hurt. And now you get it. And you get it both in written form and, better still, in audio form. And so there'll be books on tape. And I got to say that listening to Jerry rave is, you're going to like this, I promise. I think I can guarantee that. And I'm going to give you a free sample when I'm done, because otherwise you might run out on me. There's going to be, as I say, at the end I'm going to play a little bit of Jerry talking about one of his favorite musicians. Having said that for an introduction, I want to talk about Jerry as a human being. The further away we get from his death, the more people I know that, you know, that are in awe of his music, but in some cases, in many cases, it's amazing running across people that never saw him play, but still think of him as sort of godlike, which was one of the things that troubled him most and caused him to sort of want to cancel out. The long story short for my background in all this is I wrote a book about Jack Kerouac. In the process, the guy that helped me, that gave me an important shove, really important shove into writing it specifically about Kerouac, was also a Deadhead and turned me on to the Grateful Dead and took me to my first show and gave me my first hit of acid at that show, which is a good start, you know, it's a good combination. And by the way, I'm going to interrupt myself a lot. I just got hired yesterday to write the liner notes to my second show, which was in Springfield, Massachusetts in March 28th, 1973. Good God, those guys could play. But at any rate, so I wanted to do this book about the Grateful Dead, and I saw all these connections, Neil Cassady being the obvious one, but I didn't know how I was supposed to reach the Grateful Dead. And to make a long story short, and by the way, that story is in this plug. Okay, now I'm plugging. The new book, Jerry on Good Jerry, but very briefly, eventually I met Jerry and mentioned the book. And Kerouac and On the Road was a really important moment in his young life. He's 15, 16. He's a kid going to art school at what is now the Art Institute. It was then called California School of Fine Arts. Hanging out in North Beach. He always thought of himself as the youngest beatnik. He wasn't a hippie. He was the youngest beatnik. And that what Kerouac had to say about life and Ginsberg and the rest was really important to what he called his ethics, his sense that, you know, life was to be lived for the spirit and for the fun, and not for the bucks. As it happened, he managed to pull off the nice trick of getting it both, and he felt, by the way, about money that as long as he spent it faster than he had it, it was, you know, it had no effect. It was just, and he died waiting for the next paycheck. You know, you'd think he was rich, but never saved any. Which, except there was one large sum that he got, and his lawyer and his accountant said to him, "We're stealing this money." And he went, "Oh yeah?" He said, "Yeah, there's this big check you're gonna get, and you're never gonna see it. We're putting it into a secret account for your daughters, and it's gonna be there when you die, and not like all the other money that you're pissing away." And he went, "Good idea." And that money was the advance he got for the Harrington Street book. Speaking of Harrington Street. So, long story short, he said he sent a couple of guys to me to meet with me, and they said, "Jerry says, why don't you do us?" Which is to say, why don't you write a biography of the Grateful Dead? And I was trying to be cool, and I said, "Oh, that sounds like a good idea. I'll give it some thought." And then I went home and got drunk and started typing, "Jerry wants me to do this book." Among the higher moments of my life, I would say. So I started that, and then eventually I was running out of money, and Rock Scully had finally been sent to rehab, and it took them about 3 months to notice that he was gone, because he hadn't really done much as a publicist at that point for quite a while. And one day there was a band meeting, and in the Grateful Dead, a band meeting was everybody, all employees. And when it was just the band, it was called a board meeting. And one of the rules of the band meeting was that at the end of the night, the floor was open, and everybody who had anything to say could say it, you know, gripes, suggestions, whatever. And the receptionist raised her hand and said, "Look, we keep getting these media calls, and nobody calls them back." And they have to understand, you know, the media can understand it if Donald Trump doesn't return your call because he's just been caught making a really insanely stupid mistake. But generally speaking, in the entertainment business, people love that attention, and they're very, you know, they court it. They need it. The Grateful Dead didn't, exactly. At any rate, at that point, the manager was overworked and didn't like the media in the first place. So literally nobody would call. So then the media would call back, annoyed, and proceed to annoy the receptionist, who, truth be told, could annoy pretty easily. So she raised the question, and Jerry said, "Get McNally to do it. He knows that shit," which was kind of true. I'd once done a book tour, so I understood that a publicist called up members of the media and said, say something nice about my clients. Now that was 30 some odd years ago, and frankly, I haven't learned a hell of a lot since. I know more people, but you know, that's pretty much publicity. It is not rocket science. Then Jerry added that, look, send him, I'll tell him what he needs to know, send him up to the house. So I find out that I've gotten this job, and I go, oh, this is nice. And I go up to the house and sit down, and he says, okay, now here's the first thing you have to know. We don't suck up to the press. And I say, okay, okay. I might have even written it down. Don't suck up. And he says, that's pretty much it. Here, smoke this. Good job training. As my stories tend to, it leads to the next story, which was the only time that I backdoored Jerry, that I have disobeyed Jerry. Brent Midland died. Jerry was distraught, basically. I still swear that in some limited way, he blamed himself. He blamed what he'd helped create, which is namely the Grateful Dead, for not being, and it wasn't. I mean, these were six guys that acted toward each other like kind of 19-year-olds, you know? Like they knew how to give each other shit. And warm and tender, not so much. And responsive to everybody's needs, shaky. And Brent had these, this is one of the other great puzzles of the Grateful Dead. Jerry Garcia was one of the most perceptive, subtle, understanding people I will ever know. How the fuck he could pick four times in a row the same damaged personality type that went with great talent for his keyboard player is one of life's mysteries, because they were all the same person. Different but the same person. Each of them had terrible issues of self-esteem, which they proceeded to self-medicate, and eventually, one way or the other, kill themselves. God only knows. And Pigpen, you're counting. Pigpen, Keith, Brent, and Vince. And we had two sane ones that are still alive in between, in Bruce and TC. Jerry was pretty distraught after Brent died, they just sort of, he couldn't, the idea of auditioning people was, made him crazy. I mean, this idea of sitting in judgment, you're good, you're not, it horrified him, the whole thing. So they got through four guys and it was like, dear God, he being Vince, you know, do some high harmonies and play some keyboard, and we'll be having Bruce Hornsby in another, you know, 10 shows, 8 shows, whatever it was. Take him. So it was a hasty and ultimately kind of damaging decision on any number of levels, but it was made, and I went up to him after this meeting, and I said, how do you want to announce it? And he said, we're not going to announce it. To hell with it. Screw it. When we do our next show, they'll see who it is. Okay, right. So we're going to be in Cleveland, and the Cleveland Plain Dealer is going to scoop the entire nation with who the new keyboard player for the Grateful Dead is. I don't think so, Jerry. Well, obviously, I didn't say that. I just went, right. So then I'm sort of thinking, okay, how do I deal with this? Let's see. Chronicle, 30 years of close coverage of the Grateful Dead. The people I have to work with every day. Plain Dealer, nice people. Who gives a rat's ass? So the one and only time that I ever went, and then did what I wanted to do, I said, okay. So I called up Joel Selvin, and I said, okay, I'm about to tell you off the record who the new keyboard player is for the Grateful Dead. And he says, well, that's nice, but if it's off the record, you know, what the good does it do me? I said, because then you're going to call your good buddy Mickey Hart, and Mickey, who doesn't listen to Jerry in any case, and loves to see his name in the paper, Mickey will tell you exactly who it is, and you'll have your story. There won't be any problem, trust me. If I may say so, I was right. So I said, his name is Vince Wellman. End of story. Now, Jerry didn't care that it leaked because, of course, you know, there's nothing about the world of the Grateful Dead that didn't, you know, immediately leak to 50 people, you know, as soon as you turn your back. He just didn't want to be bothered. So, you know, fine. I didn't bother you. I just did it my way. Which sort of leads to the final conclusion about being a publicist, which is that despite that thing about not sucking up, and I tried not to, the fact is that you find out after a while that when you're a publicist, you have two clients. You have those lovely people that sign your paychecks, and then you have the media that you work with because you form a relationship with them, and you trade favors. And when they want something, if you can do it, they get it. And when you want something, that's when you get out the thumb screws and remind them of all the favors you've done for them in the past and get it done. But let's go back to Jerry, who, as I say, the further we get from his death, the more hazy people sort of think of him in godlike, but they take him far too seriously. One time, his daughter Annabelle arranged a kind of a not miracles. What's the when terminally ill kids or sick kids? Make a wish. Thank you. Make a wish kind of situation with a kid in a wheelchair. He wasn't terminal, but he was, you know. And I got was asked to monitor it when it actually happened. And the kid was sitting in I had him in the room where Jerry was going to come to, and he's sitting there and he's hyperventilating. He's about ready to pass out with excitement. And I looked him in the eye and I said, "Now listen, I have one thing to tell you. Jerry farts." And he sort of cracked up, I said. "And he, snores badly. Blah, blah, blah." I said, "He's a human being. If you stay in quite the excited state that you're in, he's going to get very nervous and, and in about 3 minutes, he's going to find an excuse to leave. He's absolutely happy to talk with you, but you got to talk to him like a person and not like, the president." And I might add, for once, the kid did, and Jerry did, and it worked out very nicely. But among my favorite Jerry's stories is the one about my wedding. My wife, who's a very fine photographer by the name of Susanna Millman. Okay, this is a plug, but at least it's not for me. And if you happen to be cruising on the internet, her email address is, or her website is mamarazzi.com, M-A-M-A-R-A-Z-I. You've heard of the paparazzi, she's the mamarazzi. And there are wonderful pictures in there, both of the Grateful Dead and a lot of other stuff that's too much to, she likes to take travel photography too. And she had known Jerry before I knew her. She actually taught Jerry his first lessons in Macintosh. She was the first adopter of a Mac computer, and so she was teaching everybody Mac, including me. And we started dating. Dick LaValla, of Dick's Picks, introduced us, and we started seeing each other. And at some point in there, Jerry turned to me and said, "I hear you're seeing Susanna. That's, that makes sense." She was also an insane person with a doctorate, as am I, so we were the paradox. At some point, he turned to her and said, you ought to see this. I like this McNally thing. And she later said that, what she wanted to say was, "What did he say about me?" But that was a little too seventh grade, so she just kept her mouth shut. Well, eventually, we decided to get married, and her father had passed when she was 4. So she asked Jerry to walk her down the aisle. The other person that she would have chosen was out of the country. And he said, "Okay, but I got to warn you, none of the weddings I've ever been part of have ever worked out." And we're up to 30 years now, so 30 years next month. So I guess it worked out. But that's not the story. We get to the wedding day, and Jerry, as the father of the bride's, father of the bride, is sitting in the room with the bridesmaids and the bride, and he is obviously scared shitless. And these are all people who, I mean, all these bridesmaids are other friends of his and old friends. One of them had, believe it or not, had dated Pigpen in the day. She was about 17, didn't know any better, but, you know. And she turns to Jerry and said, you're nervous, with, you know, what? And he said, well, of course I'm nervous. And she said, Jerry, you stand in front of 50,000 people and play your socks off. Well, everybody out there is your friend, or if you don't know them, they like you, don't worry about it. And, you know, what are you nervous about? He said, I don't have my axe. It's my magic shield. And it was true. He, you know, with a guitar in his hands, it's like Susanna with a camera, you know. She'd face charging rhinos with a camera in her hands. Without it, not so much. It was a great wedding, I might add. The kicker was my dear mother-in-law, who was not young and was working in the, had been working in the garment district in New York City for about 60 years, went home and is chatting with the young people of the company, and she says, you know, my daughter, she got married. This nice young man, Mr. Garcia, was, you know, part of the ceremony. The guys think, Garcia? Yes, my son-in-law, he works for this crazy band called the Grateful Dead. Ugh. Okay, so everybody's ears go up. And she says, yes, the Garcia was such a nice young man. He helped me on with my coat. And one of them says, that coat? She said, yes. Can I touch it? So, that's when she started learning what her daughter had gotten involved, well, had already been involved with for a long time. But I repeat, and my running theme here is going to be Jerry was human. I did see him, other than this, one time, really, really flustered and, you know, nervous. One of Jack Kerouac's closest friends, very, very early on, was a man named Lucien Carr. Lucien Carr, by the way, there's a horrible, horrible movie. The hell, I can't even remember what it's called now. It's just as well I've repressed it. But it's a very bad movie, and it's about an incident that did happen in which Lucien killed a man. Long story, and I don't have time to give it fair reading, but he paid his debt to society, he got out, and he proceeded to be an editor at United Press International for about 50 years. And he was my first interview when I did the Kerouac book, and he became a bit of a, you know, my father had long since died, and he became a bit of a father figure to me, and we stayed close friends till, you know, till he died. As a matter of fact, I had dinner with his widow last night, who came out to visit. Jerry knew Lucien's, knew very well who Lucien was, and Lucien had moved to D.C., so I invited him to the show, and I said to Jerry, would you like to meet Lucien Carr? And he said, oh, absolutely. But then as it approached, he actually, you know, he was visibly nervous. And he shook hands and made a wisecrack using the name that Kerouac gave him in one of the books. He said, ah, the real Roland Major. And they talked for a few minutes, and then Jerry sort of found an excuse to do, well, he had to go to work too, this is before the show. I always found it interesting that you know, that was the, about the only time. Al Gore, no problem. You know, Vice President of the United States, wasn't a problem. But you know, Lucien Carr, this interesting, but, you know, but the fact is that he had to do with the Beat Generation, and that was, you know, that was Jerry's heroes. That was Jerry, you know, so it was a genuine hero, and he felt that way. But now that I mention Al Gore, one of my favorite moments with Garcia was when we visited the White House. Now, you have to understand, this is 1992, so we've been, you know, clearly banned from the place for the previous. See, the previous administration was Bush, and what was before Bush won?
Reagan.
Previous 12 years, there was no interest in the Grateful Dead in going to the White House. This is now spring of 93, and we're coming to D.C., and a guy named Dennis Alpert, who's actually a distant cousin of Richard Alpert, otherwise known as Baba Ram Dass, he was Al Gore's, what they call in politics, director of advance, what I would call road manager. And a deadhead, and a friend of mine. And I literally got a phone call saying, "Hi, it's our house now. You want to come and play?" So I say to the band, you know, who wants to go get a, you know, insider's tour of the White House? And we did, and that was fine. And we get into Vice President, Clinton was in Atlanta that day doing something or other, maybe chasing what's her name. But Vice President Gore, you know, greets us, and you know, I'm standing there. And then he had come to the show that summer, as a matter of fact, as senator, as merely senator. Senators, feh, we had plenty of those. But he had come, and I knew he'd met people, but I decided that the situation was formal. So, Mr. Vice President, you know, Mr. Jerry Garcia, Ms. down the line of the band, everybody was there except Bobby. Bobby was lobbying over at the Interior Department. He was on it, you know. Finally, we had a Democratic administration and they might listen to him. And Vice President Gore takes us into the Oval Office. You know, now it's a hell of a room to walk into, obviously. And those of you who are my age, which is a lot of you, may remember that President Clinton selected John Kennedy's desk, which was at the Smithsonian, for his. And for those of you old enough to be somewhere near my age, you will remember these very famous pictures that were in Life magazine in the Camelot era of John Kennedy, of John, who's then about three, playing. This desk had a sort of secret door, and he was playing hide and seek with the desk. And I'm standing in the corner of the Oval Office, and there's Jerry and Vice President Gore talking about this desk. And I really had a flash. And the flash was this. Jerry was wearing sweatpants and some kind of very grappy it had long sleeves, but you know, the equivalent of a black t-shirt. There was beard dandruff all over his shirt. He looked like an unmade bed. And the vice president is wearing a, you know, $1 million suit, and I mean, you know, impeccable. The greatest thing about this is the two of them are talking with each other, and neither of them, I'm sure that the vice president did not speak with anybody nearly as slobbish that week, nor did Jerry talk with anybody that well-dressed that week. And both of them didn't give a shit. They didn't care. They were interested in each other's minds, and they were just talking to each other. And it was really lovely. It was like completely non-judgmental. As somebody who's since become Buddhist, I think of that as a great example of non-judgmentalness that they both achieved. Jerry was a genuine lover of San Francisco. One of the things that in his whole life he only did once was specifically and only because he loves this city. And that was in the spring of 1993, the Giants came this close to jetting off to Tampa Bay. And Peter McGowan and other people swiftly bought them and kept them in San Francisco and then hired Barry Bonds. A lot was going to happen later, but let's leave that to the side. Barry Bonds, you know, this incredible young star who has familial connections to the Giants. And we come to opening day at Candlestick Park, 1993. And we're on tour, and one of my co-employees was the production assistant, a guy named Eric Colby, who was a completely Looney Tunes baseball fan. His wife, among other things, worked in the Giants ticket office. And he says to the band, this is a band, it's now in 1993, 28 years in existence. And they've never done the national anthem. Now, it is a union requirement when you are an up-and-coming band. There are two things you have to do. You have to do benefits and you have to sing the national anthem at events. It's just, it's required. And for most people, it's, oh yeah, sure. Not the Grateful Dead. They, you know, they just had never done it. And Eric says to Jerry, would you do it? Or it goes to the whole, the three of them were sitting there, four of them. Phil was not available that day. So it was Jerry, Bobby, and Vince. And Bobby says, I'll do it. And Jerry says, yeah, okay, I'll do it. And Vince says, oh, okay, of course, I'll do it. Vince had, of course, many times done it. The, you know, he came from a normal rock and roll background, unlike the Grateful Dead. So it gets to the night before. I somehow, God knows why, for my sins, I became the road manager of this event. I was in charge. And it gets to the, I suggest to Jerry several times, oh, what do you think about scheduling a rehearsal? We've all known, you know, too many horrific examples of people really drop kicking the national anthem. And his response was, I know the words, leave me alone. I'm starting to get nervous. This might be the other time that I ever sort of maneuvered Jerry. And that was, So I'm starting to get nervous. So I call up Vince and I say, okay, Vince, because again, Jerry can say that shit to me. He can't say that to a fellow musician. So I said, Vince, you gotta call him. You gotta tell him you're freaking out because you haven't rehearsed. And you know, you wanna, you know, you gotta do some rehearsing. And he says, okay. I was later told they actually rehearsed for 2.5 hours. For a 2-minute song, it's pretty good for Grateful Dead. They never had that rehearsal to performance ratio in their entire lives. And for those of you who don't recall this or didn't follow baseball, they went out and they killed it, if I say so myself. And it was just one of the moments, I mean, you know, as a Giants fan myself, to get to stand on the field is kind of cool. The day before, one of the crew members, who shall remain nameless, turned to Colby and said, they're gonna suck tomorrow, and it's your fault. The Grateful Dead are not gonna go, did not go into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame based on their singing, okay? It was, you know, we'll concede that. But with a little work and a decent arrangement, what Vince called straight Sons of the Pioneers, which was the band that backed up Roy Rogers. Was it Glenn? No. Gene Autry. Gene Autry and the Sons of the Pioneers. Anyway, legitimate old school 4-part harmony, or in this case, 3-part harmony. And it was a beautiful day, I must say. And the Giants won, and Barry Bonds hit a home run, his first at bat as a Giant at home. And I was sitting behind Jerry on the seats they put up on the stage, and he's turning to his then girlfriend and wife to be and saying, That's Barry Bonds. This is actually important. But the punchline to all this is we have a press conference before the game which was fine because I had been like tap dancing and juggling balls in the air to distract them from the fact that they had to be there at 10 o'clock in the morning for sound check, but the game wasn't until 1. There was no way I was letting them leave the facility and go out in that traffic. I'd never see them again. So it, you know, it was like, how can I distract them from the fact that they're bored silly? So eventually they meet three great Giants, former Giants, which was fun. One was Gaylord Perry, and Bob Weir thought Gaylord Perry had been his all-time favorite as a kid. So Weir was like, you know, just over the moon. And then Jerry's meeting Willie McCovey. Now, to this day, I'm pretty sure Willie didn't have a clue who Jerry was. But Willie McCovey is among the more mannerly and decent human beings on the planet. And he's, you know, oh, it's a pleasure to meet you, Mr. Garcia. And then I get to Willie Mays. Now, I don't know how many of you know this, but Willie has a well-earned reputation for being a grump. And I say, Mr. Mays, could I introduce you to Jerry Garcia? He's going to sing the national anthem. No. And then he starts yelling at the other guys, come on, we got a party to go to. Let's get out of here. Now, the punchline to this is, you'd think, you know, Jerry might be a little miffed. He's laughing hysterically for two reasons. One is that he's not going to take this seriously. Willie Mays, you know, it wasn't personal. Willie Mays sort of hates everybody, at least he's grumpy with everybody. More importantly, and this goes to his entire life, the idea that there was somebody who didn't give a shit about him was so refreshing, so relieving, so made him so happy. I once saw him, we were in a Hyatt, you know, with the glass elevators, and I watched him get in the ground floor, and he was going up. And from where I stood on the floor, every time the elevator stopped, you'd watch him visibly tense up, because of course there were millions of deadheads, and they were going to get on the elevator, and they were, oh, hi, Jerry, and da, 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 you know, and it was just like, at the moment, he just wanted to, you know, shut up, you know, drink his coffee, whatever. And it stops, and I watched him tense up, and then my wife happened to get on. Well, you know, this is an exception, you know, and she just says, hi, Jerry, shuts up, and you could just watch him relax. It stopped one more time, and again, tension, and three Latino maids, hotel maids, get on. And again, you just watch this relaxation pour through him. It's like, these people do not know who I am, they don't care who I am, and this is the way I like it. So, it's understandable. A final story about that day with the Giants. We're doing the press conference. They're sitting in the dugout. And I look over and I notice that an attractive woman has suddenly, out of nowhere, slid into the dugout, sitting next to Jerry, and has her hand rather high up his thigh. And then I realize it's only Angela Alioto, and she's a politician, and, you know, politicians can't stand the idea of anybody getting attention from the media without, you know, sort of easing into the camera. So I didn't take it very seriously. And finally somebody said, well, Jerry, you know, 28 years, you've never done this before, you know, why are you doing this? And he said, well, they asked us. And he says, well, why do you think they asked you? And he says, well, it's like old whores and bad architecture. Seniority will get you everything after a while. Which was true. Told that story. I'll tell you a couple more stories, and then I'm going to let you listen to Jerry, which is, frankly, a great improvement on me. Among the more interesting conversations I ever witnessed Jerry take part in, again, talking about, in this case, not, I won't say he's godlike, but talking about one of his real strengths, which was a stunning knowledge of several subjects, one of which is the American song, all of it. We're not talking about just the blues or just rock and roll or all of it. Remember, his father was a musician. He went back. He knew old jazz. One time, I've been listening to the Europe 72 album approximately 1,000, I exaggerate, but many times. And yet, one time, I'm listening to the jam in it, in Trucken, and I suddenly realized for the first time, it was really startling, and I challenge you all to go home and listen to this, and I suddenly realized that Jerry has quoted Woody Woodpecker. There's no way that was random. I'm suddenly going, wow, he just quoted Woody Woodpecker. And the next time I saw him, I said, well, you know, I said, shit, I've listened to that 50 times. And you definitely played it. And he said, oh shit, man, you know, and he proceeds to give me the complete history of the Woody Woodpecker theme, which was performed by the Woody Herman Band. And he goes into it in considerable detail. The best example of that, and I also, I might add, saw him actually get really disappointed because we were in the basement of the Smithsonian, right? America's attic. And we're in the basement with all the good stuff that you know, they just don't have room to show you. And in their instrument collection, except, of course, these instruments weren't, they were just sitting there, so they weren't in tune. And they weren't really all that well taken care of, and he couldn't play them. I mean, he was like picking up these ancient banjos and thinking, ah, but so. But at any rate, one of the great moments I ever had with him, and it was just really quite a wonderful thing to witness. It was a Garcia band show, and we were at Madison Square Garden. And Jerry's roadie and confidant and everything was a guy named Steve Parrish. And Steve had a cousin some distance removed, because the guy's 90, and Steve was then, you know, whatever, 40, named Mitchell. Well, Mitchell Parrish was the man who wrote Stardust and Stars Fell on Alabama and a number of American classic songs. He was one of the early presidents of the ASCAP, which is the Songwriters Association. Mitchell Parrish was a big deal. He was also a very ornery guy, which is why he kept changing writing partners. Like, you know, he did one song for Hoagy Carmichael, but you notice he didn't do a bunch, or maybe he did two. So unlike some of the great, you know, Rogers and the Hammerstein and Lowe or whatever, you know, he tended not to stay with his partners. And that's possibly why he's less well known. But, you know, Stardust alone is one of the gems. And he was 90. He came to the show, came backstage to the show. He had worn out his knees, so he was in a wheelchair, but his brain, there was nothing wrong with his brain. And he and Jerry get into a rap. This is after the show. He and Jerry get into a rap. And Mitchell Parrish starts it off by saying, "When I wrote the songs for the Marx Brothers show Coconuts in 1923, and you can bet I looked it up and he wasn't BSing." It's like, okay, you know, this is like 1993, so that's 70 years later, we're listening to him. It was astonishing, outside of the fact that anybody who worked with the Marx Brothers is, you know, godlike. So they go into this wild conversation about songs and songwriting. What is amazing is Mitchell Parrish lived it. He knew those people. Jerry matched him word for word, story for story, song for song. Oh yeah, that reminds me of just out of his ears. And what was really funny is, you know, it's like one of those silent tennis games where there's two people, you know, there's 30 people in the room. Every chair is taken. It's, you know, there's everybody who could get into the room has gotten into the room. And nobody's saying a word. Everybody's just listening to this conversation because it, you know, frankly, it's worth it. It was remarkable. Including the vice president of Arista Records, who can't find any seats, so he's sitting on the floor wearing a $2,000 suit, which I loved. Both that, you know, that he couldn't find a seat and that he was willing to sit on the floor, even with his beautiful suit. Roy was actually a real person, and I find that charming. I'll just finish by saying, if you wanted a lot of guidance, Jerry Garcia would have been a terrible boss, because you weren't going to get any. Unless you screwed up, and I did once. Kreutzmann grabbed me and said, "Get him to sign this now." And I said, "Okay." When Billy Kreutzmann steps over to you and says, "Get him to sign it now," you generally want to go along with the program. Except that I hadn't looked at my watch, and it was literally, you know, they were just about to go on. And Jerry signed it for whatever reason. But the only time he ever glared at me where he was like, "You know that this is wrong." And then I looked at my watch and I said, "Oh, you know, sorry." He did compliment me twice. I'll be egotistical enough to share them because it's a little embarrassing, but this is sort of the way he worked. I mean, I worked for him for 15 years. We did a, Mickey put out a CD what the hell was it called? The Voices of the Rainforest, I think. And it was these jungle chants, mostly in languages that were the people that all died. That, you know, literally these obscure languages that didn't even, literally no one still spoke. What you want to call is a fairly obscure record. So he says, "What are we going to do about this?" And they said, "Well, you know, there's frankly only one thing to do about this if you want, you know, a lot of coverage. It was in association with the Library of Congress. And I said, the only way we're going to get any kind of coverage of this is A, ask the band to shill for you, and B, what was the other thing? And get all our political friends there. So he said, sure. Okay, I'll ask the band. And the whole band came, you know, for at least briefly. And I'd been doing the publicity at that point for a fair number of years, and I had, it was like one of those games where I had 8 significant media, say, or 10, and 5 band members plus a couple of other people from the library that were important. And I had, you know, it was like one of those puzzles where I had to get everybody to meet with everybody else, and I had half an hour or 45 minutes to do it. And I couldn't raise my voice, and I couldn't run. I had to scurry fast, but I couldn't run because I had people in different corners of the Great Hall of the Library of Congress, which is an amazing room. And I handled it that day. I only glared at one person, this kid who worked for a senator who, you know, was like running around with a Brownie camera asking all the band members to take pictures. And it's like, and I finally looked at him and I said, you know, this is not amateur hour, and, you know. But mostly, I was like tranquil, and I wanted to be Jeeves that day, you know, sort of slide around impeccably. And I came reasonably close. It was a good day, good night. And got it all done, and I was walking Jerry out to the vehicle, and he said, you know, you sort of figured out this gig in the last, how it, at that point it had been 9 years that I'd worked for him. And I thought that was like one of the great compliments that I ever got. The other one was the greatest compliment I ever got, which was the BAMMIES. So, God help us all with the Grateful Dead. In 1987, we put out an album called In the Dark, and a song on it called Touch of Grey. The Grateful Dead's one and only hit. When I walked, I was the lucky boy who walked into the dressing room in September of 1987 at Madison Square Garden and said, guys, I have some serious news. And they all sort of look at me. You now have a top 10 hit. The song is number 9. And Garcia looked at me and said, I am appalled. And he meant it. I mean, it was something just too strange about having this hit. Among other things, one of the results, well, he didn't mind cashing the checks, I might add. And he did march out as a result of that hit and buy the 16-cylinder BMW that could do 140 or something, and he enjoyed that. And Hunter bought a new house, and, you know, so everybody was okay with that part. It led to crowd control problems that is a whole different subject. It also led to the Grateful Dead winning every single award at the next March's BAMMIES, Bay Area Music Awards, which was our sort of local miniature version of the Grammys. And, you know, theoretically, well, for starters, the point is, it's theoretically at least, it wasn't really, it was fixed. It was a competition, you know, it was the public voted. And the whole idea of a competition in music struck Jerry as insane, which is why, for instance, when the Grateful Dead were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, he wouldn't go. He just said, why? You know, no, it's competition, you know, some get in and some don't. Nuh-uh, leave me out. This was by 93, and I might add that by then he was sliding into the depression that he would be in when he died. And he was in 1988, it was a lot, he was, you know, still sober from the diabetic coma he had in 86, and he recovered. And, you know, 87 was a great year of health and success and fun, and everybody was in a wonderful mood. And it was still that way in the spring of 88, and I just kept looking at him and saying, noblesse oblige. You've got friends that you've been playing with, friends you've been seeing around the city for 30 years. They want to celebrate you. And finally went, all right, I'll do it. So we get to that night, and the rest of the band is all, you know, dressed up in their black tie, and of course Jerry looked like a Joe Schmo, the schlob. Thank God. But he pulled up in the back of the Civic Auditorium, got out of his car, walked up and looked at me and said, "Man, this is the best compliment I ever got." He said, "I just couldn't figure out a way to leave you holding the bag." And I went, "I thank you for that." And there was just everything about it, you know, there was an element of competition. There was also the fact that they were going to make him play on somebody else's, on a standard amp, which is what, as a musician, he was really pissy about. And in general, it was going to be, you know, 12 people on the stage. We called it the Grateful News. It was all of the Grateful Dead and all of Huey Lewis and the News playing Good Morning Little Schoolgirl, which, you know, I mean, Huey is absolutely competent to do that, both as a harmonica player and a vocalist. When you have, you know, two of everything, or three counting drummers, and we had plenty of those to start with, it gets less, you know, it might be fun theatrically, but it's less than great music. So, that said, I want to leave you with Jerry. As I say, this is going to come out in November, and it's called Jerry on Jerry. Come on. Thank you. And in it, there, you know, there's historical chapters, and then at the end of every historical chapter, there's a place where he just sort of starts raving about something. There's one about community, and one about politics, and one about LSD, and rada rada, lots of different ones. And this one is him talking about a man named Scotty Stoneman. Scotty Stoneman was the fiddle player for the Kentucky Colonels. Scotty was maybe 10 years older than Jerry. The Colonels were his age. They were actually, this family was from somewhere appropriate, but they lived in Los Angeles, oddly enough. But they were part of this is in 1963, and they're very hot young bluegrass players and great friends of Jerry. And Scotty, who was this sort of a version of Hank Williams. He was not going to live very long because he drank anything, hair tonic, you name it, that kind of thing. But he was brilliant. And I picked this for you, if only because it is Jerry raving about something he loves, and his enthusiasm quotient is at about 101 out of a scale of 1 to 10. Which is saying something. I mean, he could get enthusiastic about a lot of stuff. But this is about the most enthusiastic I ever heard him.
It was from Scotty Stoneman.
Oh, yeah. Well, Scotty Stoneman was one of those guys that opened up music, you know? Because he'd start off with a tune, a fiddle tune, like Blackberry Blossom or some fiddle tune. And he'd take that sucker out, I mean, and it'd be like 20 minutes would go by, and he was playing ideas that went across four choruses, you know. Instead of playing the tune, it would be some crazed idea that stretched all the way across it. I mean, he was like the Coltrane of country fiddle, really. I mean, have you ever heard him play?
I'll have to
find you some tapes of him playing really outside. I mean, he played so soulfully. His playing had so much pain and beautiful, you know, and plus incredible sensibilities, man. I mean, the incredible freshness and neatness and of his ideas was just, oh. I mean, he's played some of the coolest solos in bluegrass music, bar none, you know. I mean, some of them are so fresh and so exciting. I'll have to play you my, that... There, I've got one record somewhere. It's a reissue of the Kentucky Colonels, where I do the intro. I do a live intro from a show that I put on of them, and when Scott Stoneman was playing for him, and there's two or three tunes on there where he's. And this is when I heard him play, he was sick. He was dying. He died from drinking hair tonic. You know? He's one of those guys that was an alcoholic by the time he was 14, 15. You know,
another pig.
And he died from drinking hair tonic. And when I heard him play, he was sick and dying, in fact. And, man, his playing was so gorgeous. And I knew guys that learned from him. Richard Green, that fiddler, learned from him. And, uh-huh. And he'd ask Scotty how he plays something. Scotty would just say, "I just play it lonesome, man. Just play it lonesome. Beautiful."
Well, it's interesting because, of course, your predecessor, when you're playing banjo, I think you would acknowledge that one of the guys you were super conscious of was Bill Keith.
Oh,
simply
sure.
Because he was the city guy who had, you know, made it into the real bluegrass world.
Right.
And of course his trip was you know, playing fiddle on a banjo.
Yeah.
So
and what I liked more than that was the wonderful sense of rhythmic intuition and syncopation that he had in his playing that was more subtle. It was in his roles. And his fiddle stuff was not that, I didn't get off on that much, although I learned it, of course. But it was his other stuff that knocked me out. I mean, he had a fantastic way of playing things that syncopated in surprising ways and went on and on, but did it really gracefully. Boy, he had some cool backup. His backup playing, the playing that you don't, that's not out front,
right,
that he did was what was really a knockout. Boy, I listened through the singing to what he was doing and just go, oh my God, you listen to that guy, you know? Yeah, shoo! You know, I mean, that's what I really learned from. I learned the gesture of his playing. You know, something else, I don't even know exactly what it is, but the thing of being able to extend ideas a little more and to have a fresh notion of how to syncopate things and that. And he did it, I don't know where he got that stuff, but boy, it was so cool. You know, he brought something to banjo playing for me. I mean, he influenced me in another way much more than that solo, that fiddle style.
Uh-huh.
Although the fiddle style is important, it for me, the other part of his banjo play was, because it was more like the traditional Scruggs style in sense, you know, but it had another thing altogether that it kind of, actually other banjo players didn't pick up on it. It's a little detail of his playing that kind of missed the boat, you know, that the other guys didn't catch.
And it basically comes out of rhythm.
That's what I feel. Yeah, that's what it belongs to.
That's where
it's just where you place the notes.
Where you,
where you put them rhythmically,
yeah.
And that, you know, it's something that's, it's affected my playing much more. Even, I mean, it's still in my guitar playing, and I hear it even if nobody else, even if I could never trace it down, I hear it. You know.
Well, it's just what you just said is in a sense a rewrite of a paragraph that I wrote about Kerouac and Parker, and
right
actually and Jackson Pollock,
right
in which the response to the modern post-World War II world was, and again, and it's the natural consequence of going into improvisation and into the intuitive, is you can't necessarily on the intuitive level. Well, when it all blows away, rhythm is what's going to take you there.
Yeah.
You know? And it's
you're
what
right.
pushes
it's that
there.
Bebop thing. For them, it was that bebop thing. You're right about that.
And
it's
the thing
the
is,
same sort of thing.
Monroe's bluegrass is, to me, speaking as a cultural historian, is exactly the same thing as Charlie Parker. Namely,
it's white bebop.
It's white bebop. It's taking the old, you know, the basic old stuff.
Yeah.
Pop music, gospel, blah, 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 and speeding it up.
That's
and
right.
Taking it in the 1940s, and like Max Roach told me.
The only thing it doesn't have is it doesn't have the harmonic richness of bebop. You know what I mean? That's what it's missing, but it has everything else.
Well,
and it really
went,
does.
It went the direction of the voice, and, you know.
And the fiddle, but the, well, like the fiddle playing, and the guy, like, well, Scotty Stoneman was an example of it. He was like the Charlie Parker of country fiddle, you know what I mean? You hear, I'll play some stuff for you sometime, and you'll hear it, man. You will not believe it. It is out there. You know, what would happen? He'd be playing these fiddle tunes, and pretty soon every musician on the stage would be standing there going, ding, ding. You know, they their instruments would like turn to water. You know, they'd stop playing almost entirely, and they'd just be listening to Scotty, and he'd be sawing away, man. And I mean, things would be coming out of there that would. They're like those incredible excursions Coltrane and those guys took, where all of a sudden you're hearing traffic on the streets and people hollering back and forth, and you know what I mean? With Scotty, it was diesel trucks in the highway, and you know what I mean?
Right.
And the geese flying from Canada, and I mean, everything, you know, is all there, you know, and just, oh, man, and burn it like a forest fire, you know, and never stopping to take a breath, you know what I mean? Just like a fiddle can be so relentless, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And man, when he played, it'd go on for 20 minutes and you'd be standing there. I mean, for some of the highest moments I had in an audience. In fact, the model for getting high musically for me was the thing of being in an audience and listening to Scotty play, you know.
I rest my case. Thank you all very much for coming. I am happy to answer questions, but I deny everything, so.
Can you talk about how Jerry had to learn guitar again after the diabetic coma? That must have been very scary for everyone.
I didn't know about it, so it wasn't scary to me. I'm not so sure, I wouldn't exaggerate it too much, because he went into this coma in August. I'm not sure. Merle Saunders sort of came around and started teaching, you know, reviewing the basics of music with him. I do know that in October, Sandy Rothman, his old friend, would come visit, and like a week later would come back with his instruments and instrument, and I think with David Nelson, if I recall correctly, and they played, and Jerry, you know, he didn't notice anything odd about Jerry at all. So we're only talking, you know, we're talking about a 2 month recovery time.
So it was like a blip.
So I think either that or Merle's just a hell of a therapist, but I don't think it took too long. There's an interview, and he talks about it, that's in the book, stuff that made it into the book, where I did an interview with him. I'm not sure precisely when, but I think it was in November of 86, which is to say, and you know, he was spot on. But he was also talking about the meltdown, is the way he referred to it, and he said that there were certain words or concepts even that he'd go, and he'd have to turn to people and say, "What's the word for frangis of the fin clang?" And they go, "Oh, that," and you go, "Oh, right." It's a weird thing about memory, you know. If you don't remember it, it isn't there. It's not as though you listen to the interviews in 86 and think, oh boy, he's lost a few brain cells in the interval. It's, he recovered pretty quickly. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Grateful Dead. Thank you, whatever gods you wish to invoke. Anyway else?
His dad played in a band. Was there any records of, did he play the Warfield? Is there any ads in old newspapers or anything like that?
I think that you have a job that you just assigned yourself. Not that I'm aware of, and I think it, but you know, and it's a darn good question, and somebody with even more time than I had the folks at the archive should assign an intern to go plow through and look for the name Jose Garcia in the 20s and early 30s. By the middle, the story, the family legend was that eventually he got booted out of the union for violating some rule, and in fact did open a bar, presumably called Joe's, on the corner of First and Harrison, which at different corners, as different buildings got built or torn down, he and then his widow, Mrs. Garcia, had until late in the 50s, and that's where Jerry would work there during high school time. But the answer is no. You know, he played the clarinet and other reeds, and as Jerry said, he was a genre player like I am. And don't believe it when Jerry says, A, I heard him playing because he was four when he died, and B, don't believe him when he says, I saw him die. He died drowning, he drowned fishing. It seems pretty clear that Jerry was, he heard about it so much as a kid, it sort of created a memory, but at any rate, he was there, he was around.
So what about the story that he played on Do You Want to Dance by Ernie Freeman? What's your...
It's the only time I ever caught him lying. because, you know, he really went evasive on me when I brought that up. The problem for him had been that I had interviewed Bobby Freeman at he was playing at some club. If it wasn't in the Stonestown Galleria, it was somewhere in that corner of the city, you know, a grim gig. He was a two-hit wonder. But at any rate, and I asked him, you know, did Jerry Garcia, and his first response was, there wasn't any guitar on that record. And I said, well, everybody else seems to think so. And anyway, whatever it was definitely not Jerry Garcia. It was clearly a mild little fib that in the early days, like when he was, you know, high school or, you know, early 60s, the kind of thing that a guy says, you know, Bob Dylan claimed to have recorded with Bobby Rydell, you know, et cetera. It was a harmless fib. When I asked him about it, he just sort of went, I don't remember. It's the only time he ever said that to me. So, no. Like I say, I believe that he did say that to people. I don't think so.
Oh, a couple things. One, can you talk about his relationship with David Grisman? And also, what was he most proud of as far as maybe a collaboration, a tour, an album, musically? Was there something that...
He was really proud of the first four notes of Teach Your Children Well. He said, I hit that. And, you know, all of that came in the conversation in which he was talking about doing the love theme from Michelangelo Antonioni in Zabriskie Point and doing one take and Antonioni saying, brilliant, thank you. And he went, no, I'm just getting started. No, you're fine. Actually, David Crosby did the same thing to him in the licks on Teach Your Children Well, but on reflection, Jerry said, I don't think I could have done it any better. That one I got right. Grisman, 10 seconds. He loved David. What happened was, of course, that David, their relationship fell into the aftermath of the collapse of Grateful Dead Records, when Ron Rackow took the $200,000 that was supposed to finance the record company for the next year and split. And, you know, everybody knew, Jerry included, that Rackow was, you know, he referred to himself as a barracuda. That he was a thief and that, you know, he had no ethics. But everybody assumed that, you know, that might work, you know, that he might do, you know, negative things to people outside the scene, but not us, right? But to quote Rackow, you know, I'm a barracuda and I did what barracudas do. And after a while, you turn on the hand that's feeding you and you bite it and you split. As a result of that, and I'm sure there are many other sub stories, but one thing is that Grisman had been owed, I think it was 10 grand, but whatever, a figure, significant figure to him, for his part in producing Old and in the Way, the record. And he didn't get it. There wasn't any money left. Well, you know, God love Jerry, but confronting embarrassing moments was not his strong point. And he ducked. You know, he didn't, he, you know, I don't know about him. I would have gone and said, we owe you $10,000. Eventually we'll figure out a way to get it to you. He, you know, he was so humiliated that instead of addressing it, he, you know, and Grisman can get cranky. And he just went, well, fuck you and fuck all of you, you know, and the horse you all rode in on. And he stomped off, metaphorically speaking. That's 1974. 16 years pass. Jerry, I'm not sure of the sequence of all this, but Jerry arranges for David to get a Rex Foundation grant of $10,000. See? it may take a while to come around, but it does come around. And Grisman is very pleased, and then they run into each other somewhere, I forget. David tells the story. And, you know, they're old friends, and the gap is forgotten. And he says, you know, David has a little simple recording studio in the basement of his house in Mill Valley. And he says, you know, why don't you come by and pick a little? And Jerry said, love to. Walks in, and it was just a very sweet scene. I spent a lot of time in those sessions. It was, you know, they both loved to get stoned and play music. Simple. That's what they did. And the first time Jerry was there, he walked in and said, I figured it out, man. You know, the way this will make sense is we should just decide we're making a record. So let's make a record. And Doggy said, sure, fine. And Decibel Dave, Dave Dennison, who was Dog's mixer and sound guy and recording engineer, turned on the tape recorder, and you know they had the first three songs down the first day, even before David was able to get the rest of his band in to, you know, to back them up. It was a very sweet scene. I might add that in typical Grateful Dead fashion, it produced much consternation amongst people around the Grateful Dead, because of course they were saying, well, you know, who knows what's going on over there? It's like, I can tell you, they're smoking, you know. Dog has one vice. It's called marijuana, you know. And, you know, if Jerry's gonna fall off the tracks, neither you nor David can stop it. So, you know, he's making good music. Stop. Stop with your nonsense. And he made wonderful music. As a tribute to him, I had to do this lecture at the Santa Cruz Archives, sort of driving down to Santa Cruz on August 1st, and I thought, well, okay, let's listen to a bunch of Garcia albums I haven't listened to in 30 years. You know, and the albums, you know, it's pretty much most of them. I mean, you know, when was the last time you listened to his first solo album? I don't know about you, but it's been a long time. And boy, is it good, by the way, in case you were wondering. And I also listened to some, Not For Kids Only, which is another one of my absolute favorites, especially where they do the comedy Howdy Stranger routine, which is just hysterical. But at any rate, that was their relationship, and it stayed sweet till the last music Jerry ever played was in Dog's house, recording Blue Yodel number 9 for a tribute to Jimmy Rogers that Bob Dylan was putting together.
Is that how they recorded the children's music?
Yeah, all that. Yeah, this hillside home. I'm sorry? Teddy Bear's Picnic, all that good stuff, yeah. Yeah, it was just this little, it was the, probably, I imagine it started out as two bedrooms downstairs, and they, you know, knocked it into one fairly large room, divided, so there was a control room and a recording space, and not very big, not very fancy, but good enough, and good enough to get some good sounds, and they had a lot of fun. It was a very sweet scene. That'll wake you up. Yes, and Dog's son Monroe shot some footage there, and along with I'm pulling a blank. No, I guess it was his sister.
His daughter.
Monroe's sister. Right. Yeah, right. Yeah, Dave's daughter. Them. Anyway, all that. Some more? A couple more?
Can I double dip?
Yeah.
I'm in archival one. I work very close to where he was stationed in the Presidio. Is there any records, because it's public records, all these Army records, I thought. San Bruno possibly has them. Is there any photos of him in the Army or any records from 1960?
None that I, you know, my father was in the Army for 20 years. I knew just enough to know I'm not wasting my time trying to get, you know. There's him, there's a wonderfully funny package I repeat, I'm not plugging, honest. But the Jerry on Jerry, he gets into a rap about the Army that's hysterical, his service in the Army and how ridiculous it was. And the punchline being that of course, you know, here's this kid, you know, 17, clueless, joins the Army, drops out of high school and joins the Army, which is standard practice in 1959 or 60. Thinking, well, I'll see the world, I'll get around. As he put it, shit, I barely got out of San Francisco County. Gets all the way down to Fort Ord and lands at the Presidio, which, as I said to him, you do realize that was the best assignment in the entire Army, okay? My father, 20-year man, spent, you know, I mentioned this to him once, and he was like, it's the best duty there is. It's just, you're in San Francisco, and you're taken care of, and it just, it's a headquarters situation, and blah, blah, blah. And there's Jerry driving the garbage truck, and a wrecker, and working on missiles over on the headlands in Marin. So I looked down and I said, Dizzy, you know, that'll really reassure you about the quality of the United States Army. Can you imagine Jerry Garcia working on a missile? Hard to accept. But the answer is yes. He was there. I believe him, and I have no doubt of it. But as far as records go, I don't know. Okay, a couple more.
How do you end up doing the Levi's commercial?
He wanted, who was in it with him?
Some of the guys from the acoustic band.
Whoever was in it with him, they needed the money. And he went, shit, this is, you know, for an afternoon of my time to be able to tighten them up for 10 or whatever $1,000 that they got. Strictly for that reason. He certainly didn't do it for, you know, to put anything into his pocket.
Was it hard as publicist in those last couple of years when the band's performances were lacking so much as they were Jerry in poor health? I mean, were you finding yourself up against these unfortunate questions from media about Jerry's health? And what was that like?
The media wasn't smart enough to realize that he was playing for shit. They didn't know. I never had a critic in the last 3 years of his life when they should have said, what's going on here? This guy's barely on the stage. Never once did I get a question like that. And I should have, I absolutely should have. The first show we did, and this is a little early, although it started there. In the fall of 90, we did the Europe tour. And the story I got from Steve was that Jerry did not have any drugs. And so, and of course, we were all jet lagged. We've been in Europe at least 2 days already, but we're zoned. And anyway, he just took a chunk of hash and ate it. At any rate, he was barely on the planet that night. And the number of people that came up to me and told me how brilliant a show it was like, were you there? And the funny part was, Vince, this was like Vince's 10th show or something, early on in the process. And he came off the stage, probably at intermission, and he was distraught. He was convinced it was him. And I said, no, you don't understand. Sometimes this band really sucks. It's not you, it's the band. Trust me, don't take any responsibility, you know? You got five upstanding young men that are gonna help you fuck this up. And they're doing it. And he sort of, you sure? I said, honest, really, really honest. And, oh God, they were awful. The first show of your in Sweden, Stockholm, atrocious. They got better. By the time we got to Paris, that was one of the great nights. And somehow it was the sweetest moment. People gave you champagne. I don't know why, but I kept getting shit bottles of champagne, and I don't particularly drink champagne, so I had them all. And we got to Paris, and it was a good night. They kicked some ass, and we get back to the hotel. The Grand Hotel, and the tour manager's suite had a balcony. You went on the balcony, you could see the opera house, the Paris Opera House, right? Phantom of the Opera, the original. It was neat, and we drank all the champagne and, you know, looked at the opera house, and it was like, now this is the way to conquer Europe, you know. And then I might add that the tour ended with my favorite dumbass moment. Dumbass as in I. Talk about clueless. We went into London. This is the second night, I guess, in London, maybe the third. And in the course of doing all my little political nonsense in D.C., I had met this woman who was like this, she's now a lobbyist, as they all become, who's a real political fixer, and she was good buddies with a member of parliament who I'd gotten to know, really nice guy, Neil Abercrombie. And I had said to him, as long as they're not Tories, you can invite anybody you want. One of the people there was Tony Blair, who was still, Margaret Thatcher was still prime minister. This is a year or two before he rose. And he had played in a rock and roll band at college, you know. So there's about 10 members of parliament. I'm surrounded by them backstage. They're just standing backstage, side stage. And the band goes into Maggie's Farm. Margaret Thatcher. It took me close to a minute before why is this place going completely batshit? And finally, oh, right, Maggie, that. That was wonderful. And the entire Labour Party was like ready to, you know, elect Jerry to the prime ministership. And then they really were when, but I'll tell you one story and then I'll shut up. It's a good way to end. I happened to go that night, this is Halloween. And I happened to go, I generally went in the first vehicle to go to the venue because I wanted to putter around and meet the security and tell them who they were working for and what they were gonna do. And so I get there early, and Jerry always went first. So Jerry and Vince and I are in this bus for 10. And we're crossing London, and of course, you know, there's no freeways, so it was slower than it should have been because Wembley's way the hell and gone on in the west of London, and we were in this very lovely hotel in Mayfair. And we get about halfway there, and Jerry starts mumbling, fuck, grumble, 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 grumble. And Vince goes, what? Vince goes, what? And he says, we got to do Werewolves of London. And Vince goes, you know, Vince, I don't even know if he knew the song, but it was like, it's Halloween, it's London, now, you know, how can you not do this song? And of course, Vince is going, I don't know the song. It's all right, I'll teach you. And he does. They do the show. It's a good show. It's always been my theory, by the way, if you feel free to evaluate my opinion for what it's worth. But it's always been my theory that the last show of a tour grades very high on the premise that, you know, they consciously want to leave it on the floor, leave it there, play, you know, blow it out, because tomorrow you ain't going to be working. They come back out, and of course the entire audience is going, okay, put Werewolves of London, please. And it's funny because I've listened to it a couple of times and analyzed it. It's very interesting how they adapted it. And Jerry loved Warren Zevon. Warren Zevon, I might add, opened for the Grateful Dead. The weirdest opening act the Grateful Dead ever had. It was in Santa Barbara. I was there. He was drunk, as he admitted. He was drunk at every show he played for the decade. He had a very bad problem. And the audience, you know, it was like he was made welcome at the beginning, and he played very badly. And after a while, he started abusing the audience. And the audience, being deadheads, they did a brilliant thing. They sat down and turned their backs on him because he was being abusive and boring. And, you know, then he brings out Bonnie Raitt to sing Awu. I when he brought her out, I thought, wow, do a song of hers. Maybe, you know, Angel from Montgomery. That would be really cool. No. She's brought all the way out just so she could do Awu during Werewolves of London, which Jerry had loved, you know, because they start playing it. So anyway, they what I realized that night in London was that the melody on, as you'd expect, on the Warren Zevon version, of course, is the piano, because duh, that's what Warren was playing, and it's his song. But Jerry, of course, transposes it, and he's playing it on the guitar, which gives it a snap, frankly, that Warren's really didn't have. It was, in fact, it was great. I mean, can't sing it the way Warren did, but you know, it's a great, weird song, and the Grateful Dead were a pretty good cover band, so it was a great moment. Anyway, support your public library and support Jerry's Day, and thank you all for coming.